This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Welcome to the Greencastle Baptist Church, the Church Under the Cross, online worship experience. It is our prayer that the grace, peace, and love of God abides with you. Greencastle Baptist Church is located at 4970 Murphy Lane in Louisville, Kentucky. Our pastor is the Reverend James R. Pitts. Thank you for viewing our online worship experience. Let's join today's service. Our scripture for today, Psalm 46, verses 1 through 10, New King James Version. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, even though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though its waters roar and be troubled, though the mountains shake with its swelling. There is a river whose streams shall make glad the city of God, the holy place, the tabernacle of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. She shall not be moved. God shall help her just at the break of dawn. The nations raged. The kingdoms were moved. He uttered his voice. The earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Come, behold the works of the Lord, who has made desolations in the earth. He makes war cease to the ends of the earth. He breaks the bow and cuts the spear in two. He burns the chariot in the fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. Be still and know that I am God.
Come on, put your hands together right here. Hey, so I'm going to pay homage to the Rand Missionary Baptist Church. We used to have devotion every Sunday morning, and we would just put our hands together. Somebody clap your hands like this. Hey! Yeah. All right.
Listen. Be still and know that he's God. It's already done. The back goal is one.
Anybody excited about that?
Be still and know that he's God. It's already done. The back goal is one.
That's all the song is. Help us sing it. Be still.
Be still and know that he's God.
It's already done.
It's already done.
The battle is won.
The back goal is one.
You got it now. Somebody say.
Be still and know that.
Say greater. Thank you. but don't wait. Come on, I know the bill may be big right now, but you got the victory.
You got the victory. Praise Him now.
One more time, don't wait.
And now, special music from the Mercy Ministry of Greencastle Baptist Church and a message from our pastor, Reverend James R. Pitts.
For you.
Grateful to the Lord today, if he once again has brought us through another week. This is a day that the Lord has made, and we'll be glad and rejoice in it. And we ask the Lord's blessings upon all of you as he carries us through these challenges that we face. On last time, our message came from the Gospel according to John chapter 11 and in the first 16 verses. We talked about our good and his glory. Today we're coming from that same chapter, but verses 17 through 36 of the Gospel of John. It says, then when Jesus came, he found that he had lain in the grave 4 days already. Now Bethany was nigh unto Jerusalem, about 15 furlongs off. And many of the Jews came to Martha and Mary to comfort them concerning their brother. Then Martha, as soon as she heard that Jesus was coming, went and met him, but Mary sat still in the house. Then said Martha unto Jesus, Lord, if you had been here, my brother had not died. But I know that even now, whatsoever thou would ask of God, God will give it to thee. Jesus said unto her, thy brother shall rise again. And Martha said unto him, I know that he shall rise again in the resurrection of the last day. Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Believest thou this? And she said unto him, yea, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ, the Son of God, which should come into the world. And when she had so said, she went her way and called Mary, her sister, secretly, saying, the Master is come and calls for thee. As soon as she heard that she arose quickly and came unto him. Now Jesus was not yet come into the town, but was in that place where Martha met him. The Jews then, which were with her in the house, and comforted her, when they saw Mary, that she rose up hastily and went out, followed her, saying, she goes into the grave to weep there. And then when Mary was come where Jesus was and saw him, she fell down at his feet, saying unto him, Lord, if thou hadst been here, my brother had not died. When Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping, which came with her, he groaned in the spirit and was troubled, and said, where have you laid him? They said unto him, Lord, come and see. Jesus wept. Then said the Jews, behold how he loved him. I want to speak from the subject of the resurrection and the life. The text that we we've just read presents not a historical record of resurrection life, but not only, but it's also an analogy of the elements of salvation. In this text, we'll see how resurrection life applies to us, not because Jesus came to Bethany, but because he came into the world. His coming to Bethany with resurrection life parallels his coming into the world with salvation. This text contains four basic aspects of salvation. There's humiliation, how Christ humbled himself and became a man. There's revelation, Christ declared his message. There's faith, that's the human response to the work of Jesus Christ. And then there's love, the divine motivation for salvation. We see the humbleness of Jesus in his coming to Bethany because, first of all, he did not have to come. Note here that Lazarus' sisters did not even ask him to come. They only told him that his friend Lazarus was sick. Jesus, as you know, was on a mission, moving through the world with every minute of his time strategically clocked by God. And it would have been easy for him to say, I'm sorry, y'all, I can't be bothered with Lazarus right now because I'm on a mission. I mean, after all, Lazarus is okay. I know he's sick, but he's a believer anyway. So even if something happened to him, he's going to rise at the final resurrection. And by the way, I'll be praying for y'all. Jesus could have been very indifferent, but he was not. He came back because he was needed. He knew that his enemies would be waiting for him, and the possibility of death was very real for him, but he went back anyway. Jesus was always sensitive to the needs of people, and that's why he came to Bethany. Now, when he got there, there was a great crowd of mourners at Lazarus' home going. As you know, in ancient Palestine, they hired professional mourners just in case nobody in the family wanted to cry. They would hire professional mourners, and the professional mourners were there whenever someone prominent died. And apparently, Lazarus was pretty well known in his community. So whenever someone prominent died in those days, the religious leadership came out. Lazarus must have been such a person because many people came to his funeral. And in that time and in that custom, people often stayed after the funeral for a week to comfort the family members. The burial took place immediately following death because there was no way to effectively preserve the body in the heat of that region. And so the rest of the week was filled with mourning the deceased and comforting the family. It was customary to form a long procession that would march to the tomb. And once the tomb got there, they would give various eulogies, and after returning from the tomb, a light meal was served. Everything Jesus spoke was divine truth. When he got to Bethany, he revealed divine truth about himself to Mary and Martha. Verse 20 says that when Martha heard Jesus was coming, she went to meet him. Martha went to meet him. But Mary stayed back in the house. Martha was a busy type A personality. Mary was quiet and reflective. And that's perhaps why when Jesus' arrival was announced, Martha immediately went to meet him, while Mary stayed in the house. Martha had probably been anxiously thinking over and over in her mind, if only Jesus was here, if only he would come. And then when her brother died, it probably changed to, if only Jesus had come, if only Jesus had been here. And so it was a statement of half faith and half truth. Martha believed Jesus had the power to raise Lazarus when he was sick, but not when he was dead. She had confidence in Jesus, yet she limited his power. She believed no illness could kill her brother when Jesus was there, when he was in the house. But once her brother died, she thought that even Jesus couldn't change that. But in verse 22, she says, but I know that even now, Whatever you ask of God, God will give it to you. And so what we see is a slight ray of hope in Martha's statement. Though she had doubts, she was not about to let go of the faith that she had. She knew that God would give Jesus whatever he asked, because he had been saying that throughout his ministry. Martha knew who Jesus was. She understood his relationship to God because he'd visited her home on several occasions. And Jesus said to her, he said, come here, girl. He said, let me tell you something. Your brother's going to rise again. Martha said, yeah, I know he's going to get up again. He'll rise again in the last day, the resurrection of the last day. I know that. And you would think Martha would have been overjoyed at Jesus' reply. However, she still had some doubts about his power. And she assumed that he was talking about someday and not today. But then Jesus said to her plainly, he said, look here, girl, I am the resurrection and the life. In effect, Jesus was saying it's immaterial whether you're talking about the past, the present, or the future. I am the resurrection and the life. Martha projected God's resurrection power into the future. But in effect, Jesus was saying to Martha, it's here right now and in front of you, Martha, and the resurrection power that you're looking for, look no further. It's me. Time is not an issue, because I'll resurrect Lazarus when I get ready. That Jesus is the resurrection and the life is precisely the message that this world needs to hear. Martha was thinking about an event, but Jesus directed her attention to himself. Salvation does not come in a system of religion or an ethical code. You can join churches all you want to, but that does not mean you're saved. Salvation comes in a living person, belief in Jesus the Christ, who is the resurrection and the life. And Jesus goes on to say, one who believes in me, even though he or she dies, will live. And everyone who lives believing in me does not ultimately die at all. Do you believe this? And what he was saying in verse 25, he's talking about physical life following death. That's resurrection. But in verse 26, he refers to spiritual life, or rebirth into eternal life. The human side of salvation is faith. And faith is the act of believing. He said, believest thou this? And that's a question for everyone who seeks assurance that they can come out on the other side of death into glory. That guarantee is valid only for those who believe that Jesus is the Son of God and that he has the power that can raise them from the dead. Martha believed that Jesus was the Son of God, but the girl still has some doubts. And that we might believe in Christ is the main reason that the whole book, the Gospel of John, was written in the first place. John 20 and 31, it says, but these are written that you might believe that Jesus is the Son of God, and that believing you might have life through his name. There can be no salvation without love. Love is the essential ingredient that prompts salvation and flows through every part of it. After Martha had reconfirmed in her own mind that she already believed, she took off to inform her sister of Jesus' arrival. She had become confident of Jesus' identity and his ability at what he could do. Then Jesus summoned Mary to come to him, and then knowing that the mourners, they were still down at the gravesite, were all around, he knew that the mourners would follow her to the tomb. What it was, it was a setup. Jesus had everything planned. He brought everybody that was connected with Lazarus out of the house and down to the tomb so they could all see the display of his glory. When Mary came to Jesus, she said, Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died. When Jesus saw her crying, and the people who came, they were crying, the Bible says he was troubled in his spirit. And I believe the phrase refers primarily to an involuntary groan that was the expression of his saddened heart. He was emotionally gripped by the situation. He literally troubled himself, according to the Greek text. That shows he let himself care. And he did this because he wanted to feel every pain that you and I have ever felt and the grief that we have ever experienced when we have lost loved ones. That's why he can comfort us in times of sorrow, because he's been there. Verses 34 and 35, Jesus asked the question, said, "Where have y'all laid him?" They said, "Come and see." And then it says, Jesus wept. John used a word that meant that Jesus silently burst into tears. And by the way, Jesus wept is the shortest Bible verse in the Bible. It was a spontaneous expression of love that couldn't be held back. Those tears have been, for all ages, a testimony to the humanity of Jesus. Isaiah wrote that the Messiah would be a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. The Jews who were standing around, and when they saw the tears running down Jesus' face, they said, "Behold how he loved him." Jesus crying has always intrigued me because he knew what was going to happen. So then why was he crying? Perhaps Jesus wept because he was reminded that sin destroys and sin kills. Perhaps he wept because of the unbelief that surrounded him. He had given a promise that Lazarus would rise again, but nobody seemed to believe it. Nobody seemed to embrace it. On the contrary, they were all just boo-hooing and crying. And Jesus said, in effect to them, "Y'all, it's going to be all right." But in their actions, they said, "No, it's not, because Lazarus is dead." Perhaps Jesus wept because he knew he was going to pull Lazarus out of paradise. And who wants to be pulled out of paradise? He knew he was going to have to pull him out of paradise and bring him back to this planet. Perhaps Jesus wept because although he knew everything would turn out well eventually, those around him were hurting right now. We're told in the book of Hebrews that Jesus is a high priest. He's a high priest, but he's down to earth. He's a high priest. He's not snotty. He's not puffed up. He's not high-minded. He's not arrogant. He sympathizes with us. He feels for us, and he prays on behalf of us. Jesus wept. And although it's the shortest verse in Scripture, it becomes the most powerful when seen in the light of the deity and the humanity of our Lord. In a sense, Jesus came to humanity's funeral. When Jesus came to Bethany, it was an humble, voluntary act of his will. When Jesus came into this world in a town called Bethlehem, it was also an humble, voluntary act of his will. When Jesus came to Bethany, it was to deal with death on a physical level. When he came into this world, it was to deal with death on a spiritual level. In Bethany, Jesus came to a family in need, but he also came to a world in need. He didn't have to bother with Lazarus, but he humbled himself and came. He didn't have to bother with us, but he humbled himself and he came so that he might give everlasting life to those who are dead in their trespasses and their sins. And just as he came to Bethany to restore physical life, he died on a hill called Calvary to restore eternal life. He died on a hill called Calvary, but the rest of the story is he did not stay dead. That's why he said, he did not say, "I have come that they won't have life. I have come that they will have life and that they have it more abundantly." Because even though Jesus died on a hill called Calvary, and even though they buried him in a borrowed tomb, early that Sunday morning, he got up from the grave. And so he had a right to say, I am the resurrection and the life. Let us pray. Gracious and eternal Father, we are grateful today for Jesus. We're grateful that you loved us so much that you sent your only begotten son to die on a hill called Calvary. But he died for our sins, but he didn't stay dead. He got up from the grave. We thank you, Father. This world is in a turmoil now, and there's a lot of fear and anxiety and frustration. But Father, teach us how to keep our eyes fixed and focused on you. You are the resurrection and the life, not just from the dead, but in daily life. You will resurrect us from problems. You will resurrect us from catastrophes. You will resurrect us from fear. Father, you are in total charge, and we put our lives in your hands. Thank you once again, Father, for blessing us with many blessings, those that we deserve and those that we don't deserve. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.
We want to thank Pastor for that mighty word, the resurrection and the life. Perhaps you're watching this week's sermon at home with your family, with your loved ones, and maybe you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ. We want to extend to you an invitation to Christian discipleship. And even through social distancing, Jesus is right there. So if you are without a relationship with Jesus Christ and you would like to give your life to Christ, you can call me here at the church, area code 502-243-4040 at extension 109. And I'll be happy to return your call or pray with you and help you in your journey towards a relationship with Jesus. Or perhaps you're at home and you're away from your church, or you haven't been going to church and you feel led during this time to reconnect with the church. Greencastle would be more than happy to be your church home. You can call me at that number as well, 502-243-4040. Extension 109, and either we can help you connect with Greencastle or help you connect with another church and wherever you are across this community or even perhaps across the country. We pray that during this time that you will connect with us via social media and our Facebook page. We also have an Instagram page. We also want you to be able to stay up to date with information, things that are happening within the church, decisions that are being made. You can go to our website, www.greencastle.org, and there we have information, community resource information, things are changing, we're putting up information, resources that you might be able to take advantage of in the community. We've also put up a new prayer corner, and we have information about bereavements, needs that are going on within the church. We have information about our sick and shut-in. And you can also submit a prayer request online. There's a form that you can fill out, send in your prayer request, and we'll be happy to respond to you as soon as we can. Lastly, while you're on the website, if you feel blessed by this ministry and you would like to support us financially, you can go to our donate page. We have a secured online giving tool where you can set up an account and give your offering online. You can also, of course, drop your offering off here at the church, 4970 Murphy Lane. You can drop it in the mailbox, or if you are coming through the day, Tuesday through Friday, the office is open from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. And again, as always, if there's anything that we could do, anything that you need, please feel free to give me a call, send me an email, and we pray that God would continue to bless you and your family during this challenging time. Be blessed and be safe. And God bless you.
Thank you for viewing the Green Castle Baptist Church, the Church Under the Cross online worship experience. We pray that you have been blessed by our ministry. Green Castle Baptist Church is located at 4970 Murphy Lane in Louisville, Kentucky. Our pastor is the Reverend James R. Pitts. Visit us again, and please view our other services on our website at www.greencastle.org. May the Lord bless you and keep you is our prayer.